I serve on the board of trustees for the seminary, which produces only the finest of priests. In case you needed to be reminded of that, that is St. Vincent de Paul Regional Seminary in Boynton Beach. On Friday, I had to go down for a board meeting. It's only a couple of hours of meetings, but it is one of the most dreadful rides down there. If you're familiar with Interstate 95 or the Turnpike, it doesn't matter. It's very boring. So as before I was leaving on Thursday evening, I said, well, maybe I could download an Audible book. What would be a good book to listen to that would be about 7-8 hours long that I could listen to on my way down and on my way back? So I went to my Audible app, and I guess because of some other things that I've read in recent times regarding leadership or corporate culture and values, what came up was a book called The New Gold Standard. Basically, it was a book all about the Ritz-Carlton and about the organization of the Ritz-Carlton, which is now a division of the premier hotel brand for Marriott International. So I thought, well, this sounds like kind of good mindless listening for about 4 hours down and four back. And it was actually excellent listening, because it talked in the book about their culture that they have developed. And you might say, well, they're a premium hotel brand, so they have to have this great corporate culture. Well, it's one thing to get to the top of where you're at. It's another thing to stay there. And so their organization is very committed to making sure they have high standards for their employees, that they value their employees, and that they're able really to look to the customer as giving them the highest quality of creating memorable experiences in world-class settings. I could probably work for them, I think, after reading this book and listening to it. I was rather intrigued by the whole thing, actually, and they do this by making sure their employees know something about the company, but that they know what their belief system is, their values, their steps of service. But they have something called a motto that all of the employees are asked to know. And really, I think it's beautiful because whether you're working for a hotel, whether you're working in retail, in an office, as an accountant, it doesn't really matter. You can take this motto and really live by it. And it's pretty simple. It just says, we are ladies and gentlemen serving ladies and gentlemen. In other words, they don't call their staff, or the people, or give them numbers. They call them ladies and gentlemen. And you might say, well, that sounds very Victorian. I can't really relate to that particular kind of language. But what it does is it elevates the person. It gives a sense of dignity to the person, whether they are working in the corporate office or whether they are working in one of the properties. It gives them a sense of dignity as a lady or gentleman. What a nice way to refer to one another. Not to refer to each other as that guy or that gal or you guys. No, let's have a little bit better language. And we call each other ladies and gentlemen, serving ladies and gentlemen. In other words, we realize our own self-esteem as employees, but we also realize the esteem and the dignity of other people as well. And so this helps in relationship, not just for the person, the employee, to have a good relationship with their employer, then they feel valued, but also it gives us a good sense of how they relate to one another. Because if you see yourself as a lady or gentleman and your fellow coworker as a lady or gentleman, your interactions with them will reflect that kind of language and that perception. And obviously the guest or the customer will feel it as well. I didn't totally finish the book. I got back a little quicker than I had expected. I still have about an hour left in it, but I'm looking forward to kind of getting to the end, because I realized how their company really redefined what corporate culture is, what valuing employees is, and how language can be very important. Today, Jesus gives us a new standard. Jesus gives us a manner of redefining what it is to be a disciple, really what it is to be a human being. And he does this by speaking to the people in a continuation of the Sermon on the Plain, by talking to them about how to treat one another. How to treat one another. And the people weren't very receptive to his language because they did understand what he was talking about when it came to love, to forgiveness, to giving, and to judging. First of all, Jesus tells them that love is demanding. When we think of what love is, very often we think it is an emotion, that it is something psychological. But my friends, it is beyond that. Love is something beyond. Love is not just philosophical or theological either. Love is an action. When we say that we love someone, that means it's not just simply words or verbiage, but rather it means how we treat them. And it is work. You see, the world defines love as something kind of fluffy, something soft. Oh, just love everyone. We can go back to perhaps like the 1960s and love was all over the place. But the gospel defines love as work. The gospel defines love as taking effort, as meaning that we have to invest in it and give of ourselves, because gospel values or kingdom living should tell us that love is sacrificial. And who showed us that more than Jesus himself? Secondly, the gospel today speaks of do unto others as you would have them do unto you. It is a golden rule. Hopefully one that we know, that we learn, that we live by. Well, what this really should tell us is that we are called upon to have a broader level of acceptance, a broader level of acceptance. You see, worldly living tells us, well, we can separate who do I like and who do I not like? Who am I going to be nice to? And who can I be maybe nasty to? Who can I perhaps love? And who can I, and I don't like using the word, but hate? And that's not kingdom living. Kingdom living, on the other hand, says that we look at each person made in the image and likeness of God. That means from the child in the womb to the person who is on their deathbed, up in hospice, just right up the road. It means that their life is respected. It means that they have something to offer. Not just because they're going to do something good for me. Well, what can they give me? I'll enter into a relationship if it's about what I'm receiving. No, kingdom living and doing unto others means I do because of the fact that I love. And what does that mean? It broadens that aspect that we just don't look at people in categories, but even the ones who have wronged us, we are called to love them. Finally, Jesus speaks about judgment and about stop judging. Stop judging. Nobody likes to be judged. But unfortunately, it is something that may be part of our human, our earthly nature. Because when we judge, again, we're categorizing people. We're limiting them. We're not respecting that presence of God in them. And maybe we're not seeing what the potential is because we have limited what our perception of that person is. You see, the world says, go ahead and judge. But God says, no, don't judge, because actually he is the ultimate judge. There is one judge, and that is the Almighty. And just think that if we spend our lives here on this earth judging everyone, What standard are we setting? If we say, God, I give you that privilege of judging, well, then we know that that happens when we stand before him face to face. And when he looks into our eyes and we realize we live according to his principles, not just our own. Maybe we hear these words today and we say, well, this was easy for Jesus to say. This was easy. After all, he was God. He was divine. Well, St. Paul covers that in our second reading, because St. Paul spoke about, yes, there was the first Adam, and that first Adam was made of the earth. And my friends, we are made in that image of Adam, of the earth. But Adam chose death. On the other hand, we have a second Adam, and that is Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ was fashioned from heaven and took on an earthly image as well, but he chose victory. Jesus chose life. We are brothers and sisters of Christ. That means we are brothers and sisters of the God of life, not of a culture of death. And so when we think of how we are to act, we can look and say, do I follow Adam or do I follow Jesus Christ? Adam was expelled from the garden. Jesus invites us into the kingdom. So today I ask you to think of, what is your standard, by which you live? Do you see it as a standard that perhaps is one that comes from God? Or are you willing to settle for that of the world? Because in our relationships, if we seek to have a standard of God, we will elevate ourselves, not just because we want to be elevated, but it's because of what God asks us to do for the greater kingdom and for the greater community. You see, the standards of God are not just a new gold standard that speaks to us as ladies and gentlemen. It is a standard that is eternal, that talks to us and speaks to us as sons and daughters of a God of love, of a God of forgiveness, and of a God of everlasting and eternal life.